Hi, my name is Konstantinos Maradidis, and presented here is the primary evidence supporting my thermomichlotic ape theory, together with a short review of these three surrounding ideas. Integrated within anatomical evidence are notes on the step-by-step account of the events that led to the emergence of humanity, on the proposals for more effectual experiments and new therapies relevant to all mental disorders, and on the ideas for new didactic methods which can deliver an augmentation of intellect. I have to say first for the made-up by me term thermomichlotic that it has the meaning resident of a warm fog, the central theme of a new theory on the origins of humanity and the development of human higher cognition, which I self-published back in the 5th of July 2017. For those wishing to study it more thoroughly, the book is available on Amazon. Also, YouTube's comment section is left open, welcoming those and any suggestions, regardless if you are referring to what presented in this video or to evidence included exclusively in the book. The photos used in this presentation are all in the public domain. The theory's first central claim is that all members of the genus Homo have the same environment as their birthplace, a permanent warm coastal fog, which existed at the European Atlantic Paleocoast during late Pleistocene. Shown here is a model of the European Paleocoast at all relevant times, with a permanent warm coastal fog symbolized by these light red clouds. In more detail, proposed that the permanent warm coastal fog would have existed around the contours of one or many European Paleocoasts sea glaciers or sea glaciers on North Atlantic Pleistocene islands, or both. It is also submitted for the warm coastal fog that appeared for the first time around 2.6 million years ago and lasted to around 11,000 before current era. The clouds are placed in four random positions, while in the book you can find a chapter on ways to go about investigating. It is suggested, for example, to examine the substantial archive of North Atlantic sediment cores for out-of-place bathynic foraminifera, which are bottom-dwelling, living in permanent darkness animals like these ones in this illustration. The reference here is for species with autogenous tests, like this Repmanina haroides in 6 and 7. These are drawings of two different sides of the same animal. Such tests, if found in fossil settings from North Atlantic sediment cores collected few meters away from Pleistocene shorelines, this would imply that the animals were living unsuitably in Pleistocene shallows, which the theory suggests that were shielded from the sun by a thick cover of vapor. Now, if we move to the theory's second central claim, the human higher cognition suggested as being an accumulated and heritable trauma and inflammation, mainly caused by the environmentally adjusted ancestral verbal communication system, which was employing vocalizations similar to the ones used by modern humans when communicating inside foggy environments. The warm coastal fog necessitated for a uniquely singular verbal communication system. In more detail, we are talking here about a high number of phonations, daily over 700, that are voluble above 100 decibels, carrying high frequencies exceeding 2.5 kHz and with durations usually above 3 seconds. If you have tried to communicate with someone in a foggy environment, you can recognize how the examples I am about to give you voiced, which are the same examples as you can find in the book. Only I have to warn you first that if you are listening through headphones or even through speakers, you should reduce the volume by about 60% right now, and we can resume in 5 seconds. So we are talking about vocalizations like
hey!
Meaning the word you and being the original interjection hey. Three more examples of what must have been frequent vocalizations are a woman,
hi,
a man,
hey,
I myself. It may sound comical, but consider that animal lives confined within planes. The general rule is that they communicate verbally with conspecifics when competing for social status, collect food, search for mates, and watch out for predators, while the complexity of the various communication systems observed in nature corresponds to levels of cognitive abilities. Hence, the emergence of higher cognition can come about as a byproduct of one or many of those activities only performed in a distinctly unique way. In other words, it is only in my theory for the origins of our species where our ancestors were primates, just doing the same behaviors witnessed in all other primates today. Consider also that my theory centered around high school level straightforward fluid dynamics and physics, and the supportive evidence on top of such solid foundations are comprised exclusively from unique to humans anatomical characteristics. It only requires minimal critical thinking, in addition to distancing oneself from such ideas where we are very complex species with an epic ascent to higher cognition. The theory proposes that the thick fog led to the human-like apes, which first entered 2.6 million years ago, and as a side effect of their verbal communications, to continually sending for over 700 times daily from their voice box towards their brains sound wave energy carrying unique acoustic features. These bursts of sound wave energy affecting our ancestors' brain would have increased its functional and structural wiring and led to the development of increasingly more complex communication systems. The conditions inside our species' original natural environment, that permanent warm coastal fog symbolized by the red clouds in the background here, produced a positive spiral of ever-improving cognitive abilities. Human intelligence is a byproduct of what was our ancestors' language for 2.6 million years. In more detail, one of the offered possibilities is that the mentioned voicings caused the glial fibers forming the walls of the rostral migratory stream in our ancestors' brain to open up and use the scaffolding for the radial migration of neuroblasts, ultimately producing a significant cortical enlargement. This RMS is a significant part of the mechanism involved in adult neurogenesis, where neuroblasts produced in the subventricular zone migrate in a unique pattern, this is called chain migration, to reach under normal conditions the olfactory bulb, where they are to replenish neuronal losses in the network involved in olfaction. In another possibility, in this animation, you see what postulated as the effect the same vocal communication system had on neuronal extrasynaptic receptors, that it would have induced bindings of growth factors to their receptors on extrasynaptic membranes, in turn producing an increase in the density of the same receptors and strengthen the influence of environmental cues, such as the signaling for nerve growth factor, NFG here, fibroblast growth factor, FGF, and NOTCH. This process proposed that produced a heritable trait for a significant expansion in neuronal growth rates. The book references these three papers correspondingly reporting that stimulation by those factors has been shown to induce proliferation of precursor cells and increased differentiation into neurons. A noteworthy aspect of the mentioned unique verbal communication system is that it was made possible due to warm water droplets softening the vocal folds of our ancestors. The same today are a promoting factor for singing while taking a shower. Is the salubrious effects warm water droplets have on modern humans' vocal folds that make singing while bathing more enjoyable? Also needs to be mentioned the theory's assumption that hominid groups, once they have left the warm fog, the expression from the book is a continuous trickling out of small groups, adopt oral communications with acoustic features more typical for a primate. What you see here are various members of the genus Homo producing high-frequency loud vocalizations with durations lasting over 4 seconds inside the warm fog, changing to low-frequency, short vocalizations outside under the sun. The process assumed that led to the extinction of all other members of the genus, as well as being the primary cause of all mental disorders in modern humans. So all these diseases, from depression to paranoid schizophrenia to Alzheimer's, autism, dementia, and all others, in reality are various ways by which the human brain is regressing towards an ape brain's wiring. Again, structural and functional wiring. One of the central claims is that the gradual reduction in strength of sound wave energy affecting the brain from modern oral communications due to the use of any modern language, in addition to the gradual reduction in overall verbal interactions, reduces our species' cognitive abilities to levels comparable with those of the great apes in the genus Pan. You see here the two species of that genus, the common chimpanzees on the left and bonobos on the right, also known as pygmy chimpanzees. So here you see a suggested reduction in overall ligand bindings due to the decrease in strength for the sound wave energy bursts affecting the brains of modern humans, leading to a heritable gradual reduction in receptors' densities, in turn proposed as one of the major underlying causes for all mental disorders. If we are to reverse this trend, we need to find novel ways to reintroduce as the force propping up ultimately our brain's health, all these AEEO and so on, which I name them collectively nephelologos. This is Greek for cloud language. Also keep in mind that the first indicator for any neurodegenerative disease is the decline in neuromelanin, more apparent in Parkinson's disease, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, and with markedly decreased numbers of pigmented neurons observed in Huntington's disease. However, I need to mention that only a small reduction in neuromelanin is observable in Alzheimer's syndrome. A noteworthy fact is that neuromelanin is found in much higher concentrations among humans than in all other primates, while it is absent from the brain in many lower species. Under normal conditions, neuromelanin is expressed in large quantities in catecholaminergic cells of the substantia nigra pars compacta and locus coeruleus, hence giving to both those structures their dark color. As both these are positioned superiorly to the vocal folds, their pigmentation viewed by me as the black eye of our brain. In other words, it is assumed to be the evidence for some continuous natural traumatization caused by the actions of our vocal sounds. Once usually above the age of 50, we start to speak with reduced volume, a decline in the production of neuromelanin materialized, which correlates with the vast majority of neurodegenerative diseases occurring in people over 60. The same disorders start around the age of 50 in genetic cases, and this fact offers the possibility that the genes recognized thus far most likely code for proteins responsible for particular anatomy of the soft tissue involved in speech, such as the larynx, or specific anatomy of the cranial bones. As the ferocity of this natural continuous traumatization of our brain reduced, in turn, the postulated protective function for neuromelanin, this is consistent with evidence for its affinity for a variety of inorganic and organic toxins, is reduced or lost, leading to toxic overload. You can find evidence for the importance of our voice to our brain's health in investigations made by the psychiatrist Sir Thomas Smith Clouston. When working in Edinburgh, late 19th, early 20th centuries, he recorded shapes of palates for the general population and compared these against patients with schizophrenia. 40.5% of people in the general population had typical palates, with another 40.5% having some deformities. He calls these neurotic palates, whereas only 19% had severe malformations. In patients with schizophrenia, he describes 12%, 33%, and 55% respectively. Significant numbers of patients with schizophrenia had deformed palates. Consider that our palate is operating similar to a grand piano soundboard. In a piano, the thin strings, equivalent to vocal folds, cannot radiate sound waves themselves, so their motion transferred to a much larger solid object, which serves as a more efficient radiator of sound. Clouston's research provides evidence that the directionality and intensity by which the sound wave energy transmitted through the bones of the palate towards the brain must be significant factors for its general health. For example, and as my theory proposes, it must at least exert significant influence on both the radial migration and the natural traumatization mentioned earlier. Unfortunately, since Clouston, no one has traveled down this line of investigation. However, in my opinion, the shape of all the bones of the palate primarily and all other cranial bones, as well as the shape of the voice box, should be investigated as possible factors in the development of all mental disorders. In all probabilities, a properly working as a soundboard palate, being the solid object from where the most significant part of the sound energy travels towards the brain, emitting sound wave energy bursts with the mentioned acoustic features should lead to clinical success, cure or improvement for clinical depression. In more detail, one suggestion is for the use of loudspeakers to be inserted inside the mouth and having pre-recorded sounds similar to the ones mentioned emitted towards the brain. In these photos, you see a possible new treatment, you can call it organic treatment, for patients of all mental disorders, in fact, which is also simple enough to be easily administered by anyone. Just remember to always wear a new pair of sterile gloves before any session and have all the devices you see here thoroughly cleaned with disposable antiseptic wipes before every use. Here are some examples of the more common brands. Of course, despite the treatment being of the kind that anyone can administrate, the patient at no time is to be left unattended. If for some reason the carers need to move at any distance away from the place where the treatment performed, they should remove, clean and dry all devices before doing so. Please pause the video and thoroughly study the setup of the proposed treatment. Note, for example, the grommet to protect any audio cables and the safety cord, the mouth guard to prevent abrasion with the teeth, and the plastic casing for waterproofing the speakers. Here you see the same method used for the mentioned augmentation of intellect, having kids benefiting from a proposed reintroduction of nephrologos performed as an exercise 10 to 20 minutes before the start of the next class. The setup you see here is in a school, but you can have the same at home where your children can shout from 500 to 800 times daily, such AEs, ES, and so on, and in my view, this should lead to them developing a significantly expanded intellect and have emotionally stable lives. So the method you see here is proposed both as a significant improvement to all didactic methods in use today and also as a potent preventative measure for all mental disorders. Furthermore, if yourselves are suffering from some minor behavioral disorder, in my view you can have the symptoms significantly declined by arranging for a similar self-administrated treatment. You can achieve better results by varying on the methods in here if you read loudly to yourselves, for example, your favorite novel. In all setups, breathing vapor heated at close to 25 Celsius from medical nebulizers and starting at least 10 minutes before shouting the mentioned vocalizations is needed if to avoid losing your voice. Keep always in mind that 500 to 800 shouts are to be uttered daily, all at the top of your voice. In these photos, you see an amateurish-made soundproofed box made from a plastic storage container. I am sure that similar and much better soundproof boxes can be made easily by all of you, and the use of such arrangements recommended to avoid your neighbors' complaints. Needless to say that if you notice any worsening of the symptoms or any adverse effects, you should immediately discontinue all treatments. Please carry out at least 3 months of the proposed treatments without noticing any improvements in the symptoms, and if so, then comment about the whole thing as being a hoax. Just remember that I'm not marketing anything in no way and have no association with any company manufacturing any of the devices or products necessary for the proposed treatments. I also declare that the advertisement for my book at the beginning of this video is for those interested in the origin of our species. The book does not contain any additional information in regards to what proposed as a novel treatment for all mental disorders. It is this video that contains all the relevant and some supplementary information. Therefore, I'm not recommending you purchasing the book if you are only interested to learn about these proposals for new and organic treatments. The reason I call it an organic treatment is in part because it utilizes just sound wave energy. However, the main reason comes from my belief that it was the particular acoustic features of the mentioned sound wave energy bursts from our common ancestors' phonations, repeated daily for around 2.6 million years, which affected their brains and ultimately produced all these additional connections witnessed exclusively in the brains of modern humans. The proposed singularly unique conditions inside our species' original natural environment necessitate exceptionally distinctive verbal communications, which in turn produce one-of-a-kind brains wiring. Again, we are talking here for both a functional and a structural uniqueness. Either pre-recorded when loudspeakers used or self-produced similar sound wave energy bursts. Always remember over 300 such outcries daily, each with a volume above 100 decibels, duration longer than 4 seconds, and frequency exceeding 2.5 kHz, proposed that should promote ultimately the brain's health. At this point, I have to add that Darwin tells the story of an ape that lived maybe 6 million years ago and had at random one gene of superior intellect appearing in its DNA, met a lady ape also having at random a different gene of superior intellect, together made smarter baby apes. This process continued for millions of years with new genes of superior intellect appearing every, let's say, 100,000 years, as an onwards and upwards epic ascent to the levels of intelligence we are witnessing in modern humans. According to Darwin's idea, every neurologist in the world is the owner of the full set of the best of those precious genes. It leads to exaggerated feelings of self-importance, where they view themselves as the more advanced product of this heroic fairy tale, denizens of some genetic apex for brain power. They cannot accept that they don't live in a house made of gold, but in a house made of bricks and mortar. My theory is reducing the value of their property by 99%, and this is mainly the reason why people mimicking a scientific community reject it. Unlike Darwin's naive ideas, my theory does not require from our common ape ancestors to demonstrate unique inbuilt qualities producing behaviors never witnessed in any primate, and instead proposes that it was the uniqueness of our original natural environment, the inventor of our current levels of cognitive abilities. Moreover, he stated as a general comment that the theory recognizes as a fact that levels of cognitive abilities, or if you prefer total numbers of brain connections, are directly proportional to the amount of sound wave energy affecting the brain. Allow me to repeat that my theory and subsequently these proposals for new treatments are both based on straightforward high school level fluid dynamics and physics. Also remember that all supportive evidence derives from unique to humans anatomical characteristics and requires from the average neurologist here minimal critical thinking and levels of empathy where you prioritize the well-being of hundreds of millions of fellow humans over this minor narcissistic personality disorder and any financial benefits from prescribing pills. All these things are not relevant to most of you. You keep in mind that by self-administrating or otherwise the treatments described, you could improve your lives and the lives of your loved ones. Furthermore, in general, you can continue believing in religious fairy tales or science of poor quality about a savanna origin for our species and this Darwinian accumulation of genes of superior intellect, or you can take in the truth about the emergence of humanity. Only consider that your choice can have profound effects on the futures of your descendants and our species as a whole. Ask yourselves how similar is your behavior to the one witnessed in people who are not allowing life-saving treatments for their kids on religious grounds. Their introduction of the mentioned sound wave energy bursts from Nephelologos should be the most significant part of all treatments for mental disorders, ultimately producing substantial positive effects for the lives of millions. The truth is that all kinds of vacuous beliefs deriving from an assortment of always heroic narratives create a false sense of security and hide from our eyes the inherent transience of possessing far above what is sufficient for mammal, also mysteriously produced and unaccountably supported, numbers of brain connections, the reduction of which leads humanity towards extinction. From here on, this presentation deals only with what proposes as the true origin of our species, relevant only to those who care about reaching a significantly higher level of self-awareness. As is stated earlier, I am to present here several unique to humans characteristics as indisputable supportive evidence for the idea for a place covered in warm water vapor being our species' original natural environment. However, before we go to the anatomical evidence in support of the theory, we need first to substantiate the claimed existence of the permanent warm coastal fog. As you can see this map from NASA, with the variations in surface water densities, and due mostly to their lower temperature, waters at the poles are denser than those closer to the equator. Also, when sea ice forms in the polar regions, the salt inside expelled by a process known as salt removal. Salt crystals drop through the lattice of water crystals, create first these brine veins you see here, which eventually drain downwards and increase the salinity of the waters below. The rise in salinity allows for water to stay liquid at lower temperatures and further increases its density. Moreover, it is this difference in density, temperature, and salinity between polar and equatorial waters that creates the global system of sea currents you see here, the thermohaline conveyor belt, which is mainly triggered by the formation of dense surface water masses in the northeast Atlantic. Having a closer look, waters in a region that spreads from a few degrees north of Scotland and from Iceland to Norway sink through less dense waters, a process often described as similar to rocks descending inside a lava lamp. Now imagine the same system during the late Pleistocene, where throughout the Ice Ages that started from 2.6 million years ago and lasted to 11.7 thousand years ago, the year's average sea ice cover in the North Atlantic was much larger than today. Most scientists proposing that it expanded all the way to somewhere between 60 north and 50 north. The red dotted line indicates the year's average for sea ice cover. All this extra sea ice would have produced an easily predictable, much more substantial volume for Pleistocene's denser surface waters. These two illustrations can give you a better idea of the difference between the bodies of denser surface waters as it is today here, colored in a darker shade of blue, and back during the Ice Ages in this one. Subsequently, the sinking of waters in the North Atlantic would have significantly increased, and I hope you can see it in this illustration, a significant increase in speed and volume for the descending surface waters, which is also easily predictable, together with having significantly more equatorial waters traveling north. Also, ice floats breaking from the significantly expanded sea ice cover would have reduced the amplitude of the waves over the North Atlantic currents, thus having those retaining more of their thermal energy for longer. It is from the peaks of big waves that the more substantial portion of the latent heat releases to the atmosphere. Also noteworthy is the fact that sea levels were 120 meters lower during the Ice Ages, and by my calculation, the North Atlantic currents would have been around 500 kilometers shorter, thus reaching the European Paleocoast, still retaining more of their equatorial in origin thermal energy. Finally, due to the less friction with the surrounding waters, we can safely assume for the North Atlantic currents to have, throughout the ice ages, smaller winds and depths, and travel faster to transport increased and also more concentrated amounts of thermal energy. Picture smoke pillars that rise above campfires from burning the same amount of wood in winter on the left and then in summer on the right. In colder temperatures, the mixture of the emitted airborne solid and liquid particles and gases entrains a much smaller volume of the surrounding air. Its constituents rise faster in a column with a smaller diameter and reach greater heights. In this animation, a cross-section of one of the smoke pillars is depicted having a lighter shade of red to indicate the lower temperature at the same height. In fact, for the Pleistocene North Atlantic gyre, here a diagram of that as it is today, we can easily extrapolate that it would have operated as a much smaller wheel, driven by a much more powerful and faster motor, while turning with significantly less friction. Due to all of these indisputable facts, and in tandem with the Earth's rotation, a significant part, close to their respective terminals for the Pleistocene North Atlantic drift and Norwegian currents are expected that they would have run throughout the Ice Ages parallel to the European Paleocoast. My theory proposes that large volumes of surface waters heated at close to 25 Celsius would have delivered continuously to the snouts of sea glaciers prevalent at the European Paleocoast during the Ice Ages. Moreover, also easily predictable is the presence of a permanent, extremely vigorous evaporative cooling. Thus, a permanent warm coastal fog would have existed in the coastal vicinity, again for the whole of the duration of the Ice Ages. It is difficult for me to find more ways to emphasize enough the simplicity, the straightforwardness, and the disputability of all of these facts. Moving on to the mentioned supportive of my theory evidence, I am to present next 10 unique to humans anatomical characteristics, which if added together frankly confirm that permanent warm coastal fog as our species' original natural environment. Number 1. Consider that our ancestors, as they were collecting crabs, limpets and the likes, they would have immersed themselves up to their waists in the Pleistocene's North Atlantic currents. Those are expected to demonstrate extreme turbidity, and then they would have carried all that food on to dry land where it's to be consumed. This whole exercise represents a balancing act that they would have performed many times a day and immediately from first entering the thick fog, and this suggested as the origin of the human's bipedalism. Number 2. The human's high degree of cutaneous water permeability, which indicates life in a dark, warm and humid environment. The same anatomy is to be found only on species called troglophona, which typically live in temperate caves where the humidity is ranging from 95 to 100%. A short comment here about the savanna human origin theory, the prevalent theory, which it should take a real scientist only about 3 seconds to dismiss it. Consider that waterholes in savannas, in addition to being scarce, they are also the favorite hunting grounds for all predators. As a result, all savanna animals have evolved to have a reduced need for water intake. They usually visit a waterhole once every 2 weeks, whereas they are some species, called water independent, which can go without water indefinitely, satisfying their needs from the vegetation they consume. In contrast, humans, we would have needed to visit a waterhole maybe twice a day. We die without water in less than 3 days, and we lack the ability to gulp water as fast as expected from a savanna animal. Our water intake needs are far above what you can find in any savanna animal, even of triple or quadruple size. Allow me to repeat that is expected from any real scientist to take them less than 3 seconds to dismiss any idea suggesting a savanna origin for our species. It is only fools who believe in a savanna origin for a species that demonstrates the human's deficiency in the conservation of the body's water. Number 3. The dependence of the human brain's health and evolution in omega-3 marine oils, which according to my theory stems from the oligophagous habits of our ancestors. consuming for millions of years a few species of troglophona, mainly crustaceans, and nothing else. In synopsis, is expected from the Pleistocene North Atlantic current, similarly to today's currents in this photo, to transport vast numbers of phytoplankton towards their terminals, and once those were losing access to light, they would have expired, thus providing enormous amounts of natural food to the fog's resident troglophona and stygofauna. So the crabs, limpets, slow-moving stygofauna fish and the likes would have had a high content of omega-3 marine oils themselves, and those, in turn, would have been most likely the only natural food for our ancestors for millions of years. Number 4, the lack of fur, which indicates as a species' natural environment a place both always away from light and permanently warm. The only other terrestrial mammal demonstrating the same anatomy is the naked mole rat, which lives in similar conditions. The species is native of the East African deserts, and observed that only females that are looking to establish a new colony leave their burrows, and even this is taking place always during the night. In addition to the high levels of carbon dioxide in their burrows, which does not seem to bother the naked mole rats, and which work as a heat-retaining mechanism, they also sleep in huddles, a habit that keeps them warm during the cold nights. So the two terrestrial mammals demonstrating lack of fur both live, or in our case lived, for 2.6 million years, inside environments both always away from light and permanently warm. Number 5, the protruding human facial muscles, far more developed in us than the muscles attached to the cranial bones of chimpanzees and bonobos. Both those species are much better than humans in using gestures and body posture when they try to express themselves or convey information. They employ these many times daily in all of their social interactions. On the other hand, we are much better at conveying extremely complex feelings, thoughts, and advice using facial expressions. The development of such unique to humans trait explained by the low visibility inside the permanent warm coastal fog, which required for most social interactions between our cloud-living ancestors to take place in a face-to-face manner. Number 6. The thick film of sebum from secretions of over 1,000 sebaceous glands per square centimeter on the skin of our hands and feet, which makes them uniquely adherent to rocks that are always wet with warm water due to being located within a permanent warm coastal fog. Our hands and feet are demonstrating a unique adaptation to climbing a rock surface which existed inside stable environmental conditions lasting millions of years that kept that rock surface wet with warm water day and night and all year around. Here you see a demonstration of this unique to humans anatomical peculiarity, where I dip my fingers in water heated at 25 Celsius, which improves gripping and helps me to open this plastic bag. Number 7, the recorded extremely low density of human osteocytes per cubic millimeter of mature bone, which suggested to be the byproduct of a severe transgenerational phototrauma. They are only around 700 human osteocytes per cubic millimeter of mature bone, while bovine bone has 31,900 and rat bone has 93,200. In this diagram, I have added our closest relatives, the bonobos, for which there are no measurements, so it's proposed as a means to test the theory that if the appropriate investigation takes place, their volume of bone per a single osteocyte plotted against their body mass, anticipated to be found to be on the same linear curve with all other terrestrial mammals, and with only the modern humans' reference point away from that line. In these photos, you see what proposed as cross-cultural ethnographic evidence for shared memories of the solutions found by various founders groups for populations of modern humans. On the left, you see a Sierra Leonean custom called Mende Woman, and on the right is a custom called Strohbarren from Germany. Every group of depigmented ancestors, as they were living from under the canopy of the permanent warm coastal fog, they would have covered themselves with foliage if to survive. In other words, the Mende people and the Germans respectively demonstrate with these customs that they share some collective memories from the times when their corresponding founders' groups were moving around their new sunny environments covered with various types of vegetative material. Consider that all primates have been witnessed to use leaves as umbrellas to protect themselves from heavy rain, so our ancestors demonstrate once more, in my theory, similar behaviors to the ones witnessed in all other primates today. In the book, you can find references to the Genesis story and the mentioned their need for Adam and Eve to cover themselves with fig leaves once banished from paradise, which is pretty much the same as what you see in these photos. The lack of pigmentation straightforwardly inferred from the fact that our common ancestors were living for millions of years away from light inside the permanent warm coastal fog. Number 8, my theory assumes that the same transgenerational severe phototrauma produced an enormous expansion in total bone mass, only with different results for various parts of the body. For the extremities, bones like the humerus, femur, tibia and similar, the theory postulates this lateral growth, for the head a ballooning of the cranial bones, and for the spinal column a thickening of the vertebra and the pelvic bones. Noteworthy is the fact that you are not to find not even any competing theories in regards to the development of a human-sized cranium. Number 9, these developments led to the birth canal becoming narrower, which in conjunction with the ballooning of the cranium produced this noticeable deviation from all other primates, which causes humans to have the most difficult to the mother labor. This diagram can help you visualize this. Here are the pelvic inlets from four primate species, the large white ovals, and the baby's heads, the dark solid ovals. In the book you can find references to the curse God places on Eve in the Genesis story, which in my view contains the memory of labor becoming difficult for all women starting almost immediately after leaving the cover of the permanent warm coastal fog, the paradise in that story. Finally, number 10, this ballooning of the head in turn produced this again unique to humans anatomy, where we are the only animals in the world showing the white of their eyes. In more detail, the cells in the non-pigmented portion of the ciliary body would have secreted, and still do, a higher volume of vitreous humor for the eyeball to fill the now much bigger orbit. Also, the hyalocytes would have produced, and still producing, a higher amount of collagen, hyaluronic acid, fibrils and hyaluronan. At the same time, the cells of the iris pigment epithelium could not proliferate, and the stroma of the iris could not increase in size for both of these to be consistent with a bigger eye. The function of the iris pigment epithelium is to protect from irradiation damage, which is the case for all other animals. An iris that it doesn't cover all of the eyeball's visible part would have been easily recognized as a disability if it wasn't for the fact that all of us have the same disability. In addition to all anatomical evidence in support of a place shrouded in clouds being our species origin, there is also universal ethnographic evidence for the same. For the mythologies of Egypt, Greece and Mesopotamia, primeval water was the single element that existed in the beginning, whereas for the Chinese cosmology, in the beginning was Gi, a word that has the meaning vapor, gas, life force. This picture from the Chinese mythology depicts the goddess Xi Wang Mu, the royal mother of the Western paradise, residing in her home, the covered with clouds Kunlun mountain, which is also the origin of humanity and located somewhere in the far west. Note that all pictures of paradise or similar places from all mythologies always depict a place hidden inside clouds. Other examples are Mount Olympus, as in this picture here, while a place called Niflheim, Mist Home, the first of the nine worlds, is present in Norse mythology. Lastly, this picture is from the creation myth of Hinduism, where according to Brahma Purana, preliminaries, in the beginning there was water everywhere and the Brahman slept on this water in the form of Vishnu, since water is called Nara and since Ayana means a bed, the god Vishnu is also known as Narayana. You can compare this to Christian mythology, where from Genesis 1-2 we have: Now the earth was formless and empty, darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. Very similar to Vishnu here, and a repeat of this sleeping on waters. Remember that very little light would have penetrated the warm fog, while the precipitation was always at 100%. I like to close this presentation with a statement similar to the one you can find in the 2-hour-long video on the same YouTube channel. I believe that we are hormonally predisposed to stories about a glorious origin for our species, with an always epic ascent to our current levels of intelligence, stories either originating from religions or Darwinian processes, but in nature, higher cognition can only be the result of far above average levels of sound wave energy affecting the brain. Can only be a heritable accumulated mainly inflammation, a byproduct of a series of accidents. Since they came through the last of those accidents, our ancestors passed on to us all these additional brain connections you see here, a neuroanatomical jackpot. Only today we need to shed all Molière-esque tempers, if to protect our winnings. Thank you for watching.